Okay, good morning and welcome everyone to the fourth meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones as they can interfere with the sound system, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format tablets, you might see them being used by members through the course of the meeting. We've got a full house this morning, no apologies have been received, I'm delighted to say. And we move to agenda item one, which is an overview of local government in Scotland in 2016. We will take evidence this morning on the overview of Local Government Scotland 2016 from members of the Accounts Commission, and we'd like to welcome Douglas Sinclair, the Chair of the Commission. Good morning. Ronnie Hines, the Deputy Chair. Good morning. Fraser McKinley, Controller of Audit. And Cathy McGregor from Audit Scotland, who is the Audit Manager. So you're all very welcome and thank you for coming along this morning. I've got a note here saying, Douglas, that you're keen to give us maybe an opening statement in relation to the report, and then we'll follow up with questions from members. So if you could do that now, that would be great. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Chair. Good morning. The Commission welcomes the opportunity to discuss our 2016 overview report with the committee. Scotland's councils have continued to balance their budgets each year, but with their revenue funding for the current year falling by another 5% in real terms and demand for services continuing to grow, they now have to think seriously about greater changes in the way they do things. They are now working with the NHS through the new Health and Social Care Integration Joint Boards, and the Community Empowerment Act requires councils to involve local people and communities much more in local decisions, plans and services. But the scale of the challenge in 16-17 and beyond has significantly increased. Many councils are reporting a budget shortfall, that is a shortfall between their projected income and their expenditure in future years. Councils have already reduced their spending by making incremental savings to existing services, typically reducing their workforce or increasing charges. But these are neither sufficient or sustainable solutions set against the scale of challenge facing councils. In making more significant changes, they have to have clear priorities for the longer term and make plans for the next 5 or 4 years, not just the next 2 or 3. And political pressures from the upcoming local elections may make this all the more difficult. Last year, the Commission said that councils had been dealing with reductions in income, largely by cutting the number of employees, and this has continued. But employee reductions must be made in the context of effective workforce planning, so that councils make sure they retain or develop the capacity, the skills and the knowledge that will help them deliver services differently in the future. Despite reducing their spending, indicators for 14-15 show that councils improve their performance in some areas, including educational attainment, housing quality and waste recycling, although customer satisfaction with some services, notably social care, fell. Indicators for 15-16 have yet to be reported. The recommendations in our report are directed at both senior managers and councillors, whose role continues to be more complex and demanding. We highlight yet again councillors' need for continuing training and development and good information about finance and services, including long-term financial plans. We also underline the importance of scrutiny and governance that reflects the changes councils are making in how they deliver services, including health and social care integration. The public needs to have confidence that their council's scrutiny arrangements are transparent, are independent and effective. If they are not, the public interest is not met. We intend our overview report to be a helpful summary of evidence from the wide range of local government audit work that the Commission oversees. And this year will mark a difference in how we report this. We will produce 2 complementary reports. Firstly, later this autumn, we will provide a financial overview based upon annual accounts. And secondly, in the spring, we will provide a wider overview drawing upon all audit work. We are, of course, convener, always willing to share our work with the committee to help it fulfil its responsibilities. Convener, my colleagues and I are very happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sinclair. That was very helpful. Just before I move to colleagues to ask some questions, you mentioned a few times during your presentation this morning health and social care integration, and just wondering what some of the baseline numbers in relation to council funding should look like, where we should draw that baseline. You rightly acknowledged a 5% reduction if you look at the core revenue grant to local authorities, but then you also mentioned the £250 million in relation to health and social care integration, which will, of course, predominantly be spent, however it's spent, in relation to local authority priorities through the health and social care partnerships. The government would say that then leads to a 1% rather than a 5% fall. Now, I simply don't want to get into a debate. It's not for this committee to be over those numbers, and I don't wish to do that. It's more about what monies there are in, if you like, the local authority domain, whether they direct them or receive them directly, that we should be looking at in terms of meeting the funding requirements for local authority services. So should we be looking at the monies for health and social care integration? Should we be looking at the £100 million in relation to educational attainment? It's where we draw our baseline, if you like, as a committee, to work out the money that's in the system, irrespective of whether it comes from that core revenue grant or otherwise. And I'm minded, you made the point, Mr. Sinclair, about irrespective of where the money comes from, it's where it ends up, but the scrutiny within that process as well to serve the public interest. So that might be a helpful starting point before we then go on to look at some of the more specific aspects of the report.
Absolutely. I mean, the £250 million you refer to was allocated, as you know, firstly to health boards. I think we've still got to do audit work to see the extent to which that's actually been transferred to councils. The £100 million you mentioned in terms of the government's commitment to allocate that money to head teachers, that's still, again, work in process. But again, our interest is the audit of that, to make sure that if that money does go to head teachers, how do you hold head teachers to account for that spending? What is the system you put in place to make sure that money is spent wisely and carefully? I think it's not for the Commission to get into a debate about, with government. They had a different view on this. All I would simply say is the way in which we've reported the cut in local government expenditure has been consistent year on year. I'd also make the point to some extent in the government's favour that perhaps they might have made more of the fact that even if you accept our figure, there has been a 5% cut in local government expenditure, and indeed since 2010-11, some 11%. In comparison with England, Scottish local government has compared substantially more favourably.
Mr. Sinclair, you're right. I don't wish to get into debate on the numbers either. This is challenging times for local authorities, irrespective of how we present the numbers. It's just, I suppose, we're actually getting some support from yourself as we go towards our budget scrutiny preparation to look at the monies that are in the system. Are there any other monies in the system that you would draw our attention to? I mean, the obvious ones for myself to note was the health and social care integration funds and the forthcoming educational attainment fund. Is there any monies there that you think, for the sake of scrutiny, that we might be keen to look at as a committee?
Can I ask Fraser McKinley to comment on that point?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Convener. I think the one I would maybe add to that mix is city deals. We're extremely interested to get under the skin of how the money that's flowing into the city deal arrangement is working, because, as you know, that's an even more complex picture, because some of it's local authority money, some of it's Scottish Government money, and indeed some of it is UK money. So you're absolutely right, Convener, looking at the whole system of funding for public services and local public services is an important part of our work for the Commission, and indeed for the Auditor General and for her interest in the central government side.
I think that's very helpful. I know our committee is very conscious that, you know, the Education Committee may be scrutinising the Educational Attainment Fund monies, and the Health Committee may be scrutinising the Integration Fund monies, and another committee may be looking at the City Deal. I'm sure we'll have an interest in that as well, but we want to make sure as a committee that we have an absolute focus on the monies that's in the system within local authority areas, and that was the reason to try and tease out some of the baselines. I've got a couple of bids for supplementaries on this from members. Mr. Gibson, did you want to come in on this?
Not on this specifically.
Can I take Graham Simpson first then, and then we'll come back in? Yeah.
So it was on City Deal. Do you have a concern about the level of scrutiny of the spending on the city deal projects?
I think it's fair to say that it's early days. I think councils are, given that they've come together in an area to take forward city deal money, the critical issue for them is to ensure that they do develop good governance arrangements so that they can be held to account for the money they spend, and to ensure that the collectivity of that money, if I can put it like that, does add value. And clearly, as Mr. McKinley's indicated, Audit Scotland and the Commission will take a close interest to ensure those governance arrangements are fit for purpose.
Mr. Simpson?
Sorry, my apologies.
Yes.
Just a supplementary on that. If you look at experience south of the border, where the scale of something broadly comparable to the city deals is greater, you can see from the work of one of our sister organisations, the National Audit Office, that they've got concerns about the point the Chair has made, the governance arrangements for these. I think it would be reasonably fair to say, because it's public comment, that the arrangements are playing catch-up with the political reality. So the funding has already been committed. There's drive and momentum, which is obviously a good thing behind what they're trying to achieve on the city region type deals. But the governance, I think, is still relatively young by comparison and needs to be strengthened. That's the view the NEO expressed, which I think I would endorse. We also, as a commission, had some insight into that from one of the chief executives and one of the councils involved in the Manchester deal, and he was prepared to endorse that comment. Obviously grateful for the money that was going in and the opportunity that it represented for Manchester and the greater area, but a bit concerned about the fact that the oversight of all of this was still being delivered on the hoof. So we would be concerned to look at that as it begins to develop in Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Hines. I know Elaine Smith wants a supplementary as well, but Mr. Simpson, do you want to follow up on that before we move on?
Well, just to thank you for the answer, and I think I would share your concerns about the level of scrutiny that there is, or lack of it, and indeed public accountability over these vast sums of money.
Certainly a matter our committee will be keen to return to as well. Elaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for coming and for your report that we have. In the Chair's introduction, Mr. Sinclair, you mentioned that the scale of the challenge is significantly increased and cuts can only be part of the solution. So you then go on to talk about more strategic approaches, longer-term planning, greater openness to alternative forms of service delivery, which I think some of my colleagues are going to come back to. But what you don't seem to talk about at all in the report, and please correct me if I'm wrong, I have read it and looked, is actually raising revenue. And if the, for example, if councils were to consider increases in the council tax, how that might impact. I just wonder if there's a reason for that, or if you were tasked with a different approach.
No, clearly that's an opportunity that will be open to councils. But irrespective of that, the issue for councils is to ensure that they can demonstrate that every pound they do spend is a pound that represents best value, if you want. And the danger is that if they have a funding gap, they'll simply say, oh, well, we'll just raise the council tax. Are you with me to fill that gap? I think what we're saying in the report is that councils have, to some extent, got by what we call salami slicing, by, you know, cutting services a little bit, by reducing employee numbers, or by increasing charges. Now, if you look at the duty in terms of best value, the duty is to look with an open mind and to say with an open mind, what's the best way to deliver this service? Is there a need for this service? How can we demonstrate to the public that the way we do it is the best way, is the most efficient way, is the one that can achieve that combination of quality and cost? And there shouldn't be a presumption in favour of one form of service delivery over another. Just to take the point that Ronnie Hines has made, and there's much more evidence in England of councils being more open to looking to alternative forms of service delivery, and that may be as a consequence of the much more serious financial pressures that councils are under. But I think the point that we're making, there is an obligation that councils have to their communities to demonstrate that they are delivering best value in the services they provide, that they are open to alternative forms of service delivery. And they can say, we've looked at a number of options and we've decided this is the best way to do it, and to be held accountable to the electorate for the choice they make.
Thank you, Mr. Sinclair. Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much. And just a couple of points I want to touch on is reform and reserves. And the first one, in terms of reform, you've talked about councils and health boards through health and social care partnerships. You know, have joint responsibility made a significant start in the shift from hospital care to care at home in the community. This is the most far-reaching public service reform since the establishment of the Scottish Parliament. And again, you talk about councils should be evaluating options for more significant changes to delivering key services. I'm just wondering what further reform you actually think we should be looking at. Because, for example, if you look at Orkney, they've got a health board, they've got a local authority, community planning partnerships, joint integration boards. Is there not an issue about perhaps further integration of some of these services?
Mr. Gibson, you're tempting me to get into territory that's none of the Commission's business.
you've actually mentioned it here.
Yeah,
we should look at reform.
Yeah, so. These are issues for government. It's for government to decide the structure of public services. The Commission will work within the set of decisions that government make. Our job is to ensure whatever decisions the government make, there are clear systems of governance, clear systems of accountability. I'm not trying to duck your question, but that really is an issue for government to decide what the shape and form of public services should be in Scotland.
Right, but more reform, you think, would be helpful, Mr. Hines?
Well, just to add to that, the word reform doesn't just mean restructuring, I think, so I wasn't quite sure what the intent of the question was, but if I take a broader interpretation of it, I think the Commission has already made comment in a number of areas about the speed of reform in that wider sense, some of which could relate to the integration of services. So to pick an example, since we produced this report, we reported over the summer on the state of roads maintenance in Scotland, and one of the points that we make in that report is that, frustratingly, after some 5 years that we've been commenting on this, there's very little progress in Scottish councils, or little appetite, it seems, to broaden out the delivery vehicle, if you like, for road maintenance. So, by and large, we still have 32 councils doing their own thing. There are one or two exceptions to that, but that's largely the picture. One of the things that we said 5 years ago was, why don't you join up and integrate services on a bigger scale? In order to get some economies of scale and perhaps other benefits of delivery. And that hasn't really happened yet. So we do make comment on areas like that, and I'm just using that as an example. And we would see that as quite a transformational kind of reform, and I'm not underplaying the difficulties of it. I've been there, I know how hard this can be to do. But if you want to save money without necessarily impacting on the quality of service, that's one option that's open to you. And that report points out that, in fact, the service has not improved over that period, while the money has been, I think, perforce reduced. So the opportunity, and I think the need is there, to do that kind of thing. And I could say the same thing for other aspects of local government service, but roads, we've made the case.
Okay, well, I'm actually thinking about both that type of reform and indeed structural reform. But we'll move on to one of the comments that you specifically made.
Apologies, and I will let you back in. It's just that
I know, but I'm on the same subject. It's reform. I'm even going to
specifically. Oh no, it was on shared services. So we'll come back to shared services with Ruth in a moment. Did you want to continue with that just now? We'll bring Ruth in a moment then. Okay.
Sorry, I'm not sure. Sorry, right. Have I asked a question or not? I'm not really sure.
Convenient. Ask the question, but we'll come back to shared services in a moment because I know Ruth McGrath's got a supplementary on that. Okay.
Right, okay. In your recommendations, you actually say councils are now leading complex organisations in increasingly challenging circumstances, and you talk about need to regularly review their personal training and development needs. They should work with council staff and others to create opportunities to update their knowledge and skills in increasingly important areas such as financial planning, management options, appraisal, commissioning services, partnership working and scrutiny. How appropriate is it to actually expect those level of skills from councils to be paid £16,893 a year? And how concerned are you that we're going to be unable to attract the people we require to effectively run our local authorities, given the demands? And you'll be aware very much that there's a disproportionate number of retired people, professionals, that it's very difficult to attract people of either gender who are young and perhaps have families into standing for local authorities, despite the talent that's out there. How important do you think it is to look at that specific aspect if we're going to actually improve delivery of services in Scotland?
You make a number of very fair points. I think it's fundamentally important that the public have confidence and trust in the ability of councillors to discharge their duty on their behalf. You're absolutely right to make the point that councils generally are not representative of the community. They tend to be often retired people. People have got the time to do it, and often people have to make very difficult choices between their career and participating in local government work. And as you know, the Act provides that people are entitled to reasonable time off, which is as broad as it's long, and it is difficult. But I think the point we're trying to make is, given the increasing complexity of local government, we've moved away from the idea of the council being a holistic organisation that's now involved in a much wider series of partnerships. You mentioned integrated joint boards. You look at the development of ALIOs, which didn't exist when the commission was established 40 years ago. The world has become much more complex, so the demands on councillors, whether we like it or not, are much greater. We've moved to a system whereby coalitions are the order of the day. It's quite likely that in following next year's local government elections, there will be no single party in control of any council. That's a possibility. It's a world away from local government of 50 years ago. And in that context, things like scrutiny become even more important. And the Commission's view is quite clear that if you're going to go on a scrutiny or audit committee, you should have proper training to enable you to discharge that job. If you sit in an audit committee of the Health Board, you won't get onto that committee unless you've undergone some training to do it. And I think the public has a reasonable expectation to expect that people dealing with huge amounts of money, £20 billion a year, on key committees like scrutiny, like audit, do have some training in order to discharge on their behalf their responsibilities. I'm not saying in any way you want to reduce councillors to technocrats. You with me? People make choices to get involved for very good reasons, to get involved in serving the community through their council. But in key areas like scrutiny, like audit, the Commission's very clear that given the increasing complexity, it is important that councillors have a reasonable degree of training. One of the things that we've found, just to add to the point, in our best value audits, is that the take-up of training, the training is actually available. It is very variable. There's nothing in the code of conduct for councillors that require councillors to participate in training. There's no job description for councillors. There's no job description for MSPs, and we're not suggesting there should be. We're simply saying that a number of key areas, like scrutiny, like audit, given the increasing complexity of local government, it's a reasonable public expectation that councillors have a set of skills to enable them to undertake their jobs, to hold the executive of a council to account on behalf of the public.
Okay, thank you. Fraser, did you want to come in there?
No, thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Kenny?
Do you want to move on to reserves now? Convener?
No, okay. When we do shared services, and we'll come back to that. Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I did just want to expand a bit on the second key message that you had about incremental savings no longer being sustainable. And I'd just be interested to hear your opinion on what the main blockers to shared services are. I guess it's something that it feels like it would be very sensible that there might be, savings on, scales of economy and things like that. But what we're ultimately asking, I suppose, the council officers to do is to all get together and perhaps organise themselves out of a job. Some of them, if you spoke about roads, if we have, five heads of roads and we all get together, then we no longer need five heads of that service. So I'd just be interested to hear if you had an opinion on a way forward and what you thought of that.
You put it very well. I mean, if you think prior to 1995, on the mainland, there were 9 roads authorities. There are now 29. Blockages. There's a kind of I-bin principle. We've always done it that way. And it is difficult, and it's not easy for either senior managers or for councillors to say, I want to give up control. I actually think this is a better way to provide a service. And as you rightly point out, there's often issues about jobs at the bottom line in relation to that. You might think, for example, 4 or 5 councils might say, let's come together and we'll put our benefits in one council. But if that meant shifting jobs from A to B, you with me, then that's quite an issue. Particularly in rural councils, are you with me, where the public sector and particularly the council is often the major employer. But you know, that doesn't detract from the need to deliver best value. I think there's also an interesting issue about how you bring about change in public services in Scotland. I just make the analogy with the reform in police. It's interesting that the chief constable said, you know, we're absolutely committed to cooperation between the eight forces. The evidence wasn't there to support that. And I think what happened is the government got frustrated and decided, no, we're going to pull a lever and make this happen. I think there's an issue for government to decide when does it come to a point in time when levers need to be pulled to make those changes happen. That's not an easy decision, but you know, let me just add, I don't think the Commission believes shared services are a panacea. It is one option, but it is an option if you look at these things historically to ask the question, well, if we managed before the nine roads authorities that Ronnie referred to, why do we need 29 now? And you know, the objective is always to say, it doesn't really matter who's in control of the service. The issue is to ensure you're providing the best quality services and maximising the use of that money. That should always be the driver. Having said, I appreciate it's easier said than done, but that's what good local government is about. You know, focusing absolutely on how we make sure every pound represents good value for money.
Okay. Mr. Hayes, did you want to add to that?
Just a supplementary comment, if I may. If I were to offer some kind of explanation as to why there's been so little traction on shared services despite the repeated injunctions over years, it's probably because I would see these options on a spectrum, and I think the actual sharing of services with all the reorganisation and the aspects that you drew attention to, namely that where there were several, now there's only one, so who would voluntarily go that way? We've started at the most difficult point in the spectrum. If you consider, for example, easier issues to contemplate, just the sharing of information is a good start. So why does it cost something here and something a lot less there to deliver what's ostensibly the same quality of service? And there's plenty of data around that shows that that is indeed the case for a range of services. And I'm pleased to say that local government has now recognised that and has seized that particular initiative. And there are forums there, active forums, for sharing that kind of information. Now, you would hope that as a consequence of that, some of the conversations that are taking place at local level would be, well, why is it that you continue to do better than we do, despite the fact that we're trying to learn from you? Maybe the easy option or the right option now is for us to just make common cause with you and to take a further step in that direction. So we either hand the service over to you or we come together in some fashion. Now, there have been examples where that has happened. It happened, for example, between Clackmannan and Stirling in relation to education and social work. Unfortunately, that did not stay the course, because I think they hadn't done the groundwork to begin with, and it was a politically led initiative that didn't survive a change of leadership or administration. So those are the hazards. But if you do start from the bottom and build up from there, I would be hopeful that under the pressure that councils are under, sooner or later they will come to the recognition themselves that you have to make common cause, as I put it. You have to share these services, not just the information. But the information by itself can lead to efficiencies, and I think there's evidence that's happening.
Ruth, would you like to say
that? I thank the gentleman there for their answers. I think there is a bit there about the tension that the political cycle brings as well, because all these are big bits of work. They're big projects to bring these large organisations together and working together, and I think that there's a definite tension there.
Let's maybe bring Ronnie in, because he knows an awful lot more about this than I do. Is you don't have to share services to reduce costs. There's a huge amount of work that the local government benchmarking framework have been doing for a number of years, which enables councils to drill down and look at their costs in comparison with similar councils and to say, well, if they can collect the council tax for that and it's costing us that, how come they can do it for that and we can't? So that, you know, if there's a willingness in councils to be open and to think, can we do this better, and ask the question, we can do it better, then I think there are real opportunities. Ronnie, do you want to add to that? There's a very interesting example on libraries that I think we were sharing with the committee.
Yeah, well, just to start with, it's in the report. We, in the report that's in front of you, we looked at one aspect of the benchmarking framework that Douglas has referred to, which was absence management. And we posed the question, what if all councils performed at the level of the best or the average? And we're able to put a figure on the headcount that you might save, if everybody was able to do that. So that was a first venture into that area for us in the overview report. And I suspect we'll be following that up in the next iteration of this. And Douglas has just referred to one case that might be worth looking at, because local government is doing it themselves. And I think that's important to stress. That's where this information is coming from. They've sat down in what they call their family groups and have said, well, of all of us who are broadly like each other, so we're not comparing Glasgow and with Angus here, we're choosing councils that have chosen to see themselves as similar. And if we all delivered library services in the same way as even the average of us, we could save something like 10% of the cost of library services. And that's on top of quite significant savings that have already been made in library services. So we're not starting with low-hanging fruit, if you like. So the power of this way of doing it, I think, is manifest when you look at that. And the good news is that that is exactly what local government is doing for themselves. Our role, I think, is to encourage that, to promote it, and to report on it so that we foment good practice.
Thank you.
OK. Now, Elaine will bring in a second, but I'd supplement you on this also. Now, I just double-checked the name of it. The Clyde Valley Shared Services Review, I think, 2010-2011. So it was... Inverclyde Council, North Lanarkshire, South Lanarkshire, Renfrew, Glasgow and Eastern Bartonshire. And just to quote from one of their summary reports, there's a compelling business case for shared and support services of finance, payroll, revenues and benefits, human resources and IT across the Clyde Valley. Any progress in any of that?
Not so much, convener. No, I think the answer. And I think when the question was asked about what are the barriers to shared services, the Clyde Valley experience, which came from the report that John Arbuthnot did, is, I think, an interesting case study in why it's so difficult. And for me, I think Ronnie touched on it in terms of the scale and the complexity and the ambition of that exercise, with that many councils, with that many different interests, with that many different political positions and everything else that comes with it. That was always going to be a hard sell. I think people have probably learn some lessons from that exercise, and what we're seeing now are kind of smaller scale but still very worthwhile exercises in collaboration. So a recent one with Highland, Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire collaborating around the procurement service. My guess is that's the kind of model we're looking at into the future, rather than the big scale shared services where you put everything together in a warehouse in the middle of somewhere. Do you know, I think the nature of shared services as we knew it 10 years ago is probably moved on a bit.
Can I just ask, and I'm focusing specifically on that because that was an example of a number of local authorities where there, by and large, there was, if you like, there were similar political hues as well, which perhaps made it a little bit easier for the local authorities to talk to each other. There was a real determination to drive this forward, and then almost nothing. I think Mr. Sinclair also pointed out about at what point does government sit there and go, well, you keep talking about doing this, and at what point do we, rather than enable them to do it, does governments dictate or drive some of this themselves? So what are the barriers that you think the government could help remove, and where's the cultural resistance in this that you think maybe this is a committee we could explore a little bit more ourselves in relation to the local authorities in question?
So on the Clyde Valley thing, you know, I think just briefly to say that while not much was delivered as intended through the Clyde Valley Partnership, I think what's interesting is that there have been lots of smaller things that have come out of that process. So rather than the five or six councils doing things together, two or three councils are doing things together. And I think they would probably argue that the process and the discussions and to some extent the trust that was established through that Clyde Valley process allowed them to do other things. I mean, really, as the chair said earlier, it's a judgment call for the government as to what and when and how they pull a lever around some of this stuff. Mm. My sense is that local government themselves are recognising the need to do more of this. The financial pressure is clearly a driver for that, but so is the need to deliver better services and better outcomes for communities. And as I say, you can see across the country, particularly around areas of health and social care and other things where people are now becoming are getting together and looking to do things differently.
There are, also more recently, some straws in the wind. The Ayrshire Roads Alliance, the Inverclyde East Day Dumbartonshire, made a commitment to share services. And it may be, we mentioned City Deals earlier, and it may be out of City Deals that there'll be a willingness to look at shared services again. But as I say earlier, as I said earlier on, it is one option, but it isn't the only option. And I think it's important to say that it's not the only option to reduce costs.
Hopeful, Mr. McKinley or Mr. Sinclair, if you could give us, maybe write to us with examples of where lessons have been learned from that particular review, and smaller examples of shared services have been teased out. Maybe even just write to the committee with
that. I think you raise a very interesting point, because certainly we've had some discussions in terms of whether we should do a piece of work as to following shared services, given the enthusiasm, why that enthusiasm wasn't translated into delivery. I think there's an interesting audit study to be done in there.
Well, a supplementary from Elaine Smith, and then we'll move on.
Thanks, Convener. So when you talk about issues and problems with shared services, and you've also mentioned ALIOs in your part two of your key messages on delivering services, would you perhaps consider that part of the problem might be public accountability? And so the example I would give is for if North and South Lanarkshire decided to share education services, for example, as has happened in another area where it didn't work out, then as a resident of North Lanarkshire, I might be concerned that it was councillors in South Lanarkshire who were making decisions who I had not elected. And so as part of that, in listening to your evidence, I hear you saying several times about the previous 9 councils that delivered roads, for example. So are we actually, in terms of public accountability, and you also talked about central direction, but are we perhaps, is this leading us to consider that in the 90s, when local government was reorganised, that was a political decision in the early 90s to remove regions and districts and totally reorganise? But is this argument around shared services, different ways of delivery, ALIOs, etc., is this just an argument for a total reform again of local government to make it more accountable to the public who elect councillors, but to look at shared services in a far more structured way, i.e. districts and regions once more?
Yeah. Well, as I said earlier, these are really issues for government. I think it is important, whenever councils do set up a shared services model, that there are clear lines of accountability to local communities. So, for example, if you look at, say, councils in Ayrshire who've come together in terms of roads authorities, there should be a clear line of accountability, a clear line of reporting back to each individual council as to how that service is performing in relation to the needs of the separate councils. What I'm trying to say is that it really is in the design of that's absolutely critically important to get that right. I do understand the point you're making, and I think to some extent that was an issue with the Clackmannan and Stirling model of education, that in a sense people felt as though the thing was being driven by one council rather than the other. So I think the critical issue is to get that design right. It doesn't mean the shared services are wrong in principle, but there needs to be absolute clarity from the beginning in terms of the shared services. What is that shared services model set up to deliver, and how do we ensure accountability to each individual council and in turn to the local communities? That's the key issue. It's difficult. I'm not suggesting it isn't difficult, but I think it can be done.
In terms of ALIOs as well, which I mentioned, is there less public accountability with ALIOs?
I don't think there has to be. I think there are some councils who have very extensive ALIOs and a very effective system of monitoring the performance of their ALIOs. Again, it's the issue, if councillors set up an ALIO, they need to ensure that the responsibility for the quality of the service and the money that's often invested in the ALIO remains with the council, right? And they're still accountable for that. The key challenge for the council is how do they monitor the performance of the ALIO? How do they assure their communities that the ALIO that they've set up is delivering on the objectives set by the council? How do they ensure that the representatives they've appointed to the ALIO are reporting back regularly to the council on how the ALIO is performing? There's nothing in principle wrong with ALIOs. It's the arrangements for ensuring their accountability is the key issues. If you look across the border in England, in many cases, ALIOs have delivered quite interesting forms of service innovation. In Scotland, I think, to a large extent, they've been set up to save money and non-domestic rates. I think there's still a bit to go to ensure that ALIOs, with the space and the time, can be an innovative way of service delivery. But they're only one opportunity. As I mentioned earlier, when the Commission was established 40 years ago, ALIOs were not part of a firmament. They are now. They're a big part of the firmament. They employ a lot of people and they spend a lot of money. And certainly, looking forward as a Commission to the next iteration of Best Value, we will be looking very closely at the relationship between councils and ALIOs and ensuring that councils do hold the ALIOs that they've established are held to account on behalf of their constituents.
Okay, thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you very much for your presentation so far today. It's covered many issues, but the one area I want to focus on is, you know, councils have extensively balanced their budgets and managed things as they move forward. The medium-term and the long-term financial planning that they now have to face under the current financial pressures make life very difficult, and we understand that. But then they have the added extra with council debt, and that council debt can have a huge implication about the financial stability and sustainability of the council going forward. I'd like to sort of tease out from you how that's managed, because if it isn't managed effectively, it could tip them over the balance as we go forward. And we know that times as we go forward over the next few years are going to be even more demanding, and there's going to be more pressures, and that debt and these will grow and add even more pressure to the whole process.
Just make the opening comment, then I'll ask Fraser and Ronnie if they want to add anything. Debt is okay as long as it's affordable. That's the key issue. I'll maybe bring Fraser in on this one.
And I think that is the key issue, Mr. Stewart. I think that what's really important, and as we mentioned in this report, the Commission reported. A while back on borrowing and treasury management specifically in a separate report we did last year. And I think what one of the key findings in there was ensuring that when councillors are being asked to make some quite significant decisions around borrowing, that they understand the implications of that, because the borrowing needs to be repaid. So in particular, what they need to understand is the proportion of their revenue spend, the kind of day-to-day spend, is actually then servicing the debt, is a hugely important question, and as we see in the report, there are big variations across the country. Now, it's not for the Commission or Audit Scotland to come up with a magic figure that says this is safe and this isn't safe. What is absolutely key is that they are making those decisions in the context of a medium and long-term financial strategy that's underpinned by strong financial plans, and that councillors are given the right kind of information to help them take those decisions in the full knowledge of the implications, not just next year, but 5, 10, 15, in some cases, 20, 30 years down the line. In a sense, it comes back to the conversation that Mr. Gibson, the Chair, had about the training for councillors who are involved in making those kinds of decisions. We're asking them to make some pretty sophisticated calls on some pretty sophisticated things. And if anything, with new forms of innovative financing coming in, there's tax incremental financing and all sorts of stuff, it seems like every week we come up with a new acronym for a new way of borrowing money. Very, very complicated stuff. And I think our role is to keep, I'll use the phrase banging on, because that's probably how it feels, to keep banging on about the importance of the financial strategy and the solid information.
I would have put that in a more subtle way, but never mind, yes. Ronnie.
Just to sketch out the Chair's point about affordability. The first thing to offer is an assurance to the committee that the Commission is on the case. You see it's in the report, the overview report, but we also did quite a detailed piece of bespoke work quite recently on council borrowing and all the complexities that go with that. And it is a very complex area, treasury management in its entirety. So we do keep quite a close eye on this. We're conscious of the importance of debt against a background of declining resources, because that's the issue. The debt's fixed by and large for a longer term, whereas the resources are declining over a shorter term. So when do we get to a pinch point with affordability? And I think I'm safe in saying here right now that we don't think local government as a whole is in that position, and we haven't identified for any individual council that they're in that position, but we are keeping an eye on it. It's also worth bearing in mind that some of that debt, well, all of that debt, one hopes, is incurred for very good reason. And one of the good reasons might be that it allows the opportunity for other aspects of expenditure to be managed downwards. So if councils are borrowing money, for example, to build new schools, one would expect those new schools to be cheaper to maintain than the ones that they are replacing. If they're doing it to put new IT in place, there should be some productivity gains associated with that, so other aspects of the revenue costs should come down. So you can't look at the debt in isolation, but back to my opening comment, we do just the same, just to make sure that it is being well managed because of the size of it and the importance over the long term.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just make just one postscript to that, if I may, convener? It's just in terms of our next iteration of Best Value, when we'll be looking at all 32 councils over the next 5 years. And one of the key issues that we will be looking at in terms of the audit of those councils will be financial sustainability.
That's helpful. Graham Simpson.
Yeah, really just following on from that and some of the things you've said earlier, they are linked. The ability of councillors to scrutinise these very complex issues, and I should declare I am an existing councillor. I should have said that at the start, but it is relevant. I think is lacking. And you mentioned having training for councillors. I wonder whether that training should be provided not by councils but by somebody else. I just think bringing in outsiders is probably better. I've got to confess that I think councillors' eyes often glaze over when they see complex reports, particularly financial reports, and so the level of scrutiny isn't really there. So I wonder if you could comment on that. And then going back to Alexander's point, you mentioned in your report about the use of reserves by councils. I think this is becoming quite an issue. Are they starting to dip into reserves, and are we in danger of getting to a danger point?
See, just before you answer that question, thanks, Graham, that's very helpful. See, that first question you asked about bringing in external, are you making the point that council, senior council officials' capacity building councillors to scrutinise senior council officials? Is that...
Yes.
I'm just wondering in relation to... So we get some clarity around that, because I'm quite keen to hear the answer, but I'm just...
Yes, convener, it just occurred to me when you were speaking, I thought, actually, to be trained by your own council to scrutinise your own council is maybe not the best way of doing it.
That's helpful, thanks.
Some very interesting points there, both about training and about reserves. Where to begin? Quite a lot of training is provided by the improvement service rather than by councils themselves. So that is a resource that councils can access. I think, generally speaking, councillors are pretty good at doing induction training, right? So that when you start off as a councillor, you'll get training in terms of what does the monitoring officer do, what's the role of councillors and the role of officers. I think what it fails down is what I call continuous professional development. If you look at other professions, like a lawyer, like an accountant, then there's an obligation to take up training. Where training isn't provided, things can go badly wrong. I think that one of the most powerful examples is Rotherham Council, where there's child exploitation on a very significant scale. And the failure of the scrutiny committee was palpable. Now, you could put that down to the lack of confidence in members and being able to challenge officers or a lack of training, but it does underline the importance of councillors having the confidence and having the skills to scrutinise officers effectively. I do understand the point you make about making reports accessible. The report should be written in a language that's accessible to councillors. And in a number of audit reports, we've made that comment that it's not for officers to pull the wool over the eyes of members. These are complex issues, and officers have a duty to ensure that members do understand the issues in front of them. I think there's also a big issue of much greater involvement in councillors in the design of training. There's an assumption that councillors, when they join the council, don't know anything. They do know a lot about some things. And I think the training was much more designed to fill the gaps that they need. And I think there is the outstanding issue I mentioned earlier about how do you ensure a better take-up of training. We have a report coming out quite soon on roles and relationships, and one of the things we do suggest, as I mentioned earlier, that in some critical areas, particularly like scrutiny and audit, that training should be mandatory. In the same way that if you sit on a planning committee or the licensing board, you won't get on that committee unless you've undergone some training. I think the other point you make about reserves, and again I'll ask Fraser and Ronnie if they want to come in, the Commission's golden rule is they can only be used once. You can only use your reserves once, and there's certainly evidence of a number of councils who've filled the funding gap, are you with me, by just saying, oh, well, we use the reserves. That's not a sustainable long-term solution. You're ducking the questions, a bit like the issue of, well, if we have a funding gap, we'll simply raise the council tax. You come back to the point of ensuring that instead of cutting services, you cut costs, first of all. I don't know, Fraser, Ronnie, you want to add to that?
Briefly, Convener, just very briefly on the point about training, can I make a plug for external auditors in that context, particularly around audit committees and financial sustainability and those things? The Commission appoint independently auditors of all 32 councils, and they're always very happy to do that kind of independent training for audit members, and we're delighted to do that when we can. On the use of reserves, the Exhibit 7 in the report, page 18, I think, is the bit that we're always most interested in, because, again, it's legitimate, and councils would argue that the reason they've been building up reserves is for a rainy day, and it's now raining, so that's kind of why they're doing it. I think our problem with that a little bit is that when you look at the numbers that we've tried to capture there in Exhibit 7, half of them haven't planned to do what they ended up doing. So it's absolutely legitimate to use reserves as part of a planned financial strategy going ahead. But as you can see, both up and down, a good number of councils didn't use reserves in the way they had planned at the start of the year. So that would be our concern about the use of reserves. And as the Chair says, any sense that year on year councils are relying on reserves to plug a gap, because that's not sustainable.
Graham, do you want to follow up on some of that? So Mr. Hines, did you want to add to that first?
Just very briefly on the specific question of who trains the councillors on things like treasury management, I would probably, and we did touch on this in the report that I referred to on treasury management, I'd point out there's maybe a distinction between training that's intended to give an understanding of the subject matter, and it is a very technical area, and frankly, local government directors of finance are the experts on this, on the one hand, and on the other hand, training in how to hold people to account, whether it's on that or something else. And I think with that distinction, I could see the point about someone other than the council officers being the ones who help to impart the skills on how to ask the right questions, how to be dissatisfied with not the best answer and how to follow it through, as opposed to understanding the technicalities of short, long-term borrowing. So there's maybe just something to think about in that regard. On the question of reserves, the only thing I'd add to what Douglas and Fraser have already said is that, in point of fact, the level of reserves has been increasing over the last few years. What we're interested in is the deployment of them. Douglas's point is the fundamental one. You can only use them once, but how effectively are they being used? We see plenty of examples where money is set aside in order to fund some innovation so that there's a long-term benefit. What we're really interested in is the meat on the bones there. What actually happened? Was that money really used for that purpose? Where's the evidence that it's had that result, as opposed to being used as a temporary gap between a budget this year and a budget next year, which is always a temptation if you put additional money in someone's hands. So we want to see councils providing evidence that money had, that the reserves have been used for that kind of purpose, and they can show that that's exactly what's happened.
Okay, thank you. Now I'll take Kenneth Gibson a second for a supplementary on this, but Graham Simpson, do you want to follow up?
Just to say, I think we've touched on some interesting issues there. You're absolutely right about if you sit on the licensing board, as I do, you have to pass an exam to sit on that board. So I actually passed, incredibly.
Smiling because it's not multiple choice.
Yeah. so why not in other areas?
And if you could give all the councillors on this committee here today marks out of 10 for the level of scrutiny, that would be helpful as well. Thank you.
Maybe not.
Yeah. Do you want to reply to that comment?
No, we'll leave it as it is.
No takers, we'll leave that hanging. Go for that one. Mr. Gibson.
Okay, well, thank you very much, convener. I mean, Exhibit 6 is quite interesting because the variation of the 30 councils that you've outlined is between 3 and 23% in terms of level of reserve. And, of course, you've added a caveat about Orkney and Shetland because of the vast reserves they have. And you have said that reserves should not be to support day-to-day spending because it's unsustainable. But while you go on in paragraph 20, say the level of reserves that a council holds is a local decision, but should be clearly formed by an annual reviewed reserves policy. Surely the Accounts Commission must have some kind of view as to what the kind of average, shall we say, level of reserves should be, particularly given the fact that local authorities, as Mr. McKinley has pointed out, don't even seem to follow their own reserve policy in 50% of cases on an annualised basis.
We've always resisted the temptation to quote a number, Mr. Gibson, because as soon as the Commission does that, that people begin to construe that as a target and you end up getting into discussions about whether you're above it or below it and whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. So, I mean, clearly, and we have said this in some councils going back a bit, if a council is operating with close to no reserves at all, our auditors absolutely would raise a concern about financial sustainability, because if that's the case, then if something unexpected were to happen, they wouldn't have the funds to meet that. But beyond that kind of principle, we haven't quoted a number, because the thing we're more interested in is the kind of qualitative nature of the plans that underpin those reserves, and as Ronnie Hine said, what they actually plan to do with it. The experience from the Commission, having done this work now over a number of years, is that, and this is a good thing, we now have much more transparency over what reserves look like in councils. So going back 10 years, we couldn't have produced Exhibit 6. And partly, I think, it's because the Commission have been encouraging councils to be more transparent about not just the totality of reserves, but what they're actually planning to do with them. And then related to Exhibit 6, as well as the variation, Exhibit 7 and the extent to which the uses as planned is the thing that we are very interested in.
Okay, but I mean, I do think, though, surely that's a bit of a cop-out. There has to be some guidance. I mean, surely if Glasgow's at 3%, I mean, is that, you know, for example, slightly more than you think would be a minimum, slightly less? I would have thought there has to be some kind of benchmark here, surely. And I mean, people of Inverclyde, for example, not getting the services they perhaps should because it's at 23%. And what you've also mentioned in paragraph 18, the fact that the reserves, despite all the reductions in local government expenditure, are 39% higher than they were in 2010-11. So they're talking about a rainy day is now arrived, but for some councils, it always seems to be next year or the year after. It seems contradictory that reserves are going up while budgets are going down. But it's just a huge disparity. And you could perhaps advise us what Shetland Island Council's oil-based reserve actually is in relative to its annual expenditure.
We can come back in the second one. I don't have the up-to-date number in front of Mr. Gibson, but we can certainly write to the committee with that. Do you want me to take the other point? So again, I think without doing the work that we do across 32 councils, Mr. Gibson, to look at the nature of the plans that underpin those levels of reserves, I'm not in a position to sit here today and to say that the Glasgow numbers good, bad or indifferent, or equally that the Inverclyde one's good, bad or indifferent. Your point about it feeling counterintuitive, I would absolutely agree with. And it's a challenge we've laid at the door of councils a number of times, not least in this report, where on one hand we recognise that financial pressures are mounting, that services are being cut, and at the same time reserves are being replenished. Now again, if that's part of a planned approach, particularly to take Ronnie's point, to investing, particularly in investing for innovation and invest to save kind of things, that's absolutely fine. The reason I mentioned Exhibit 7 is that the 8 councils that we report who did not plan to increase their reserves but did is is as concerning for us as the ones who did the other way around. Yeah. So just because they ended up on the right side of the line doesn't mean it's all right. From that point of view, I would absolutely agree. But that says more about their financial planning and their financial management than it does the absolute level of reserves and whether they're in the right place or not.
So just a final comment, convener. But surely that is a real issue. I mean, if half of them are even following their own plans, how can you have any kind of faith in the fact that these proposals that they're putting forward in terms of the reserves are appropriate in any way at all? I mean, you know, it could be, for example, how do we know that Inverclyde isn't even lower than it perhaps should be? One could even suggest, you know, because if plans are not being actually followed, it almost seems to be a meaningless exercise. This is a kind of year-to-year thing, you know, that local authorities are doing, lack of forward planning. It must give serious consideration, and it must surely make you want to drill much further down into the whole aspect of reserves and planning for reserves and how those are actually ultimately drawn down by the local authorities who do draw them down.
Volunteered to make a comment on this.
Just to give Fraser some relief, I suppose. For me, the key thing is that the reserves are just one aspect, albeit an important one, of the point that you're really making, I think, about overall financial planning. It will be part of what a good council does to plan for a given outcome for the financial year, and an aspect of that will be what we expect the reserves to be compared to what they were at the beginning. But the key point is that it's in that wider context, and it's that area of financial planning that this report and a lot of the work that we do tries to be clearer about. What we say is that we see quite significant variation in practice between the 32 councils. Some work on a shorter term basis, some work on a longer term basis, some cope better with the uncertainties and the slings and arrows out there, even though, for example, in the current year, everybody was confined to a one-year horizon so far as Scottish Government funding was concerned. Nevertheless, some councils are able to look beyond that and say, we've got a longer-term strategy, we'll do some scenario planning, and we'll work our way through that uncertainty until things change. So that, for me, is the right context for this. The reserves are almost a consequence of that, and to home in on those would probably get us into relatively unproductive territory, which is why Fraser says we've always taken a self-denying ordinance about that. But again, I would want you to rest assured that when the auditors do their work annually, one of the things that they will look at is that financial planning, and one of the consequences being the level of reserves will attract comment if we think it's moved significantly one way or the other. So the local audit work that's done on the ground, which supports all of this that you see reported here, is actually an important part of how councils themselves are held to account. And we would expect councillors to be asking the kind of question you're asking now. I thought we were going to see a reduction in reserves this year, Director of Finance, but they went up. Why is that? And that seems to me to be the right area to follow that through.
Thank you. Can I just check before we move on to Mr. Whiteman, is that the way reserves are presented across all local authorities in accounting terms and how they're audited for, is that the same across all 32 local authorities? Are local authorities bound to give projections the same way in what the reserves will look like from one year to next? Is there a set procedure in audit terms or accounting terms and how they would have to explain away the rationale for fluctuations in reserves? In other words, are we just picking apples with apples so that councils can effectively scrutinise their officials?
Yes and no is the answer to that question.
Good,
convener.
Right.
Yes, in that when we do the audit of the financial statements, that's done the same way 32 times over, and councils have to present the financial information the same way in terms of the totality of the general fund reserves and other reserves too. Where there is more local flexibility, if you want to call it that, is, for example, in Exhibit 6, we talk about allocated and unallocated. The definitions of allocated and unallocated will inevitably vary from council to council, which is why, as well as the, if you like, the really important but narrow audit of the financial statements to give the true and fair opinion, which our guys do, what we talk about in public audit terms is the wider scope. So how is that governed? What's financial management like? The financial sustainability, which is where we get into more of the qualitative assessment about the nature of the plans that underpin these things. And year on year, and the chair mentioned our refresh to best value, this an important part of that story is the extent to which councils are delivering as planned. And if you've got a council that is continually and serially underspending its budget, even though it's not meaning to, then that would raise almost as big a flag for us as it would councils who are overspending, because I think, as Mr Gibson suggested, presumably that money was due to be spent on something and it hasn't been. So that's how we would actually go about that, and we do that in all 32 councils.
Okay.
Just a postscript. I've listened to this. I think we've given a reasonable explanation of the Commission's position why we don't have a target or a benchmark. There may be mileage in the point about us being clearer about allocated and unallocated, so there's more consistency across the council. I think we'll take that point away and have a think about it. I think there's something in that. Just in terms of public transparency and accountability, I think that's important that councils use that, you know, are adopting a similar definition.
Okay, thank you very much. The very patient Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for coming along today. I want to pick up on message 5 in part 1, where you talk about the challenging financial environment and the need for effective medium and longer term financial planning being critical for councils. And you say that this is more challenging for councils when they don't know what their future funding and income will be. I'm wondering if you've got any comment on what role greater fiscal autonomy might play in enabling councils to achieve that better ability to long-term plan, and whether you think there's any merit in exploring what the UK government and the Scottish government have arrived at, which is a fiscal framework, whether there's any merit in exploring a fiscal framework between Scottish government and local authorities. And perhaps a good example of that might be what's happened to the council tax and your report on the council tax freeze, and of course that will be being lifted. But because the overall compensation that's been provided that's built up cumulatively will not be being replaced, as it were, that's a kind of one-off reduction on the floor of council tax receipts, which has never been part of any agreement or whatever.
Who'd like to answer that?
I'm happy to.
Mr. McKinley again, yes.
Shall I go first?
It's a difficult question, so I'll get Fraser to answer it.
That's why I get him. I'll do my best, Mr. Whiteman. So, it's a fascinating question, and certainly now that councils have the ability to vary council tax, it will be very interesting to see the extent to which they choose to do that. And as you know, the council tax makes up a relatively small proportion of their overall funding, so for it to be meaningful, I think the sense is that the council tax increases would need to be fairly substantial to really make a difference, if you like, in terms of the overall pot. We can certainly see in some medium long-term financial planning that is happening that councils are beginning to factor that into their thinking. No decisions having been made yet, because obviously that will be for the budget round coming up, but there's definitely moves out there that people are saying, well, if we were to increase council tax by 2%, it would provide X million pounds. The thing about the fiscal framework and indeed just more immediately the budget cycle, we recognise and accept does make it difficult. I mean, an ideal world, councils would know how much money they're going to have for the next 3-5 years. But to be fair, Scottish Government doesn't know that either. So we live in a world in which they need to figure that out. Our contention, I think the Commission's been very clear that if anything, that kind of medium to long-term financial planning is even more important in those circumstances, because you need to have scenarios, you need to think about the options of a best case, a worst case, and what that might mean. Otherwise, you're kind of going from one year to the next and trying to figure out as you go. So you'll be aware, I'm sure, that there's a review of the budget process underway involving Parliament and others, and the Auditor General's involved in that. And it'll be interesting to see what that brings out for the budget cycle next year. But my sense is this year in particular, we are going to be in a similar kind of place, which is why we will continue to encourage councils to do better scenario planning and to think more long term, even though they don't know for sure how much money they're going to get.
Okay, anyone else like to add to that?
Just two comments on the specific point about the council tax freeze. When that unfreezes after nearly 10 years, it will be interesting to see how that is handled in local government, and we'll be keeping a brief on that. And one reason that we would do that is because the majority of directors of finance will never have experienced the setting of a council budget where a variation in the level of council tax was a genuine option. The freeze has meant that it's a given. It's effectively a part of the Scottish Government support, the funding arrangement, whereas the calibration that had accompanied the status quo before that was always an important part of the local democratic process. And directors of finance had to advise councillors on the option of raising council tax by a given amount or reducing expenditure by a given amount. That trade-off hasn't happened meaningfully for a decade, so we will be looking carefully to see how that's handled at budget-setting processes and obviously after that as we look retrospectively at the accounts. An associated point I might offer in relation to that, and it's contained in the report at Exhibit 2, shows that the council tax as it stood at the time of this report was just over 10%. It was 11% or so of the total income that councils were spending. It also says in the report that roughly £500 million is what's now in the Scottish Government funding to local government to compensate for the council tax freeze. So rough and ready, if you take that £500 million and add it to the £2 billion that's mentioned in here, you would increase the proportion of overall income from 11% to something like 14%. Now, that doesn't mean that you've got real fiscal autonomy, but it is a small step in that direction, and that's what's going to happen after the council tax unfreezes. So I think, not to repeat my first point, I think as people get onto that path again, we will have to look carefully at just what that means for the level of local taxation. There was an example, you remember, last year where one council, because of what the Scottish Government proposed for the funding settlement, intended to ask its local population how they would feel about a council tax increase of something around 20%. I think it was quite high. So that didn't happen. But the point is that we have to recognise that when the freeze unfreezes, those kind of options become viable. Whether they're palatable at a local level is another issue. But, you know, all that stasis for 10 years means that when it starts to unpack, I wouldn't necessarily expect it's going to be a slow, gradual process everywhere. The temptation to do something other than that will be a real one, and a valid one.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Whiteman. Do you want to come back?
Yes. The reason I raised particularly the question of the fiscal framework is because, of course, Fraser says that councils will, the council tax freeze will end, and they'll have the ability to set the rate of council tax. Of course, they've always had that ability. Sure. It's been a political pressure that has, and that will continue in the future. So the reason to talk about the fiscal framework is and a greater autonomy perhaps is that in the case of Edinburgh, for example, there's been discussions about a tourism tax to deal with the additional costs that the city faces during the summer months and the festival, etc. This place has resisted that. There's an argument for them, councils having more autonomy, and the decision as to whether to apply one is a political decision for the council itself, in consultation with Chamber of Commerce and tourism industry and hotels and the citizens and all the rest of it, and whether changing the extent to which councils have flexibility and autonomy in what tax base they have, how it's designed, how it might apply, whether one place might want to increase council tax on holiday homes, another one might want to reduce it, etc., how that greater flexibility might help in medium and long-term planning. I don't expect a definitive answer, just some indication, because you are raising in your audit here obviously some serious concerns about the future. You're not just restricting yourself to strict audit on an annual basis and very helpfully providing us with pointers of the challenges. And our job in committee, both and the Parliament here, is to actually to grapple with these questions and see how we can help to make it easier to do medium and long-term planning.
Given that we've got 10 minutes left of this session, I think you'll be pleased that we're not looking for a definitive answer in all of that. But when you do answer it, it might be worthwhile viewing it in the context as well of the Scottish Government's aspiration to assign income tax revenues from local areas into local government funds. And no more clear on how that's going to operate, but I suspect that would sit within any new fiscal or financial framework.
I'll just kick off on this one. I think you raise some interesting issues which are, in a sense, beyond the Commission's remit. But there's a long outstanding issue about, if you want local government to be truly accountable to its communities, then it should raise at least 50% of its income. That's a position that COSLA has always taken, local government has always taken. So there's a debate in there which goes beyond the council tax in terms of a variety of taxes, in terms of how you ensure that.
makes that happen. And it's a perennial debate. I mean, it goes back years after years, and the number of Royal Commissions have looked at this issue over the year and have made the point that if you want local government to be truly accountable, then you need to change the balance of control between central government and local government. Having said that, because central government is always one of the key funders of local government, it's natural that they'll want to have a degree of input in relation to that to ensure, and it's always this balance between local discretion in terms of the services you provide, as opposed to the government's desire, whatever colour of the government is, to see some degree of uniformity across standards. It's a continuing debate, and a debate that is far from resolution, and I think it's, you know, I think that the debate in Edinburgh is an interesting one in terms of looking at how you widen the tax base. All these things have consequences, but it's, you know, I'm sure it's a debate that will continue, and one which the Commission will watch with interest. Is it?
No, just once we leave here, the three of us are going up to ponder our strategy for the Accounts Commission over the next few years. So I'll take that point on board. I think that's a helpful comment. I could see some useful joint consideration between the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission in the wider context that I think you're drawing our attention to, not just local government funding and taxation, but against that bigger background for what's happening with the Scottish Government's funding and taxation. Is there a piece of work, perhaps, that looks at that in the round over the next few years as the situation evolves? I think that's a helpful comment.
Okay, thank you very much. Any further bids from committee members for questions? Mr. Simpson put his hand up before you, Mr. Gibson, sorry. I'll take you in, we've got time. Yes.
I must have been quick. Can I ask you about pension deficits? Because you do refer to them in your report. You say they're not a concern, but they are growing. And at the time that you looked at them, they were at the level of £10 billion. Which strikes me as a rather a lot of money, and if they're increasing, at what point do we get to the stage where they are a concern? And would you be prepared to sort of say what limit, where, how far we should go before we say enough's enough?
In the report, there is a gap, but I think the people in control of the pension funds believe that they're manageable. It's obviously something that we do keep a close eye on. Just a slight diversion on that, there was a piece of work that Cosla commissioned a few years ago in terms of shared services, which asked the question as to whether we needed eight pension funds, I think, in Scotland.
More than that.
11 pension funds, as to whether you could drive efficiencies by reducing the number of pension funds, which is what has happened in England. But that work didn't proceed. I don't know whether Fraser or Cathy have anything to add to that, but it's clearly something we'll keep a watching eye on.
Yes, I think we said in the report that there are plans to reduce the deficit, and the reason for not being immediately concerned is that there are 20 years to do that. But obviously, as auditors, we'll be keeping an eye on that.
What you don't say is what those plans are.
I don't have the detail of all the plans at the moment.
We could drop a note to the committee on that one. Yeah,
I think also just to say that, as the chair mentioned right at the start, we're producing a separate and specific report this year in November. Yes. Is the plan around the finances of local government. This report combines the two things, finance and performance, and we're kind of separating those out this year. So again, pensions will get a good dose of coverage in that report, and be very happy to come back and talk to you at that point.
Just a quick reassurance. One, this is complex, but one of the factors that is relevant here is that there's now a ceiling on the employer's contributions into the pension fund scheme, so it's not a runaway truck, if you like. And that's partly a reflection of the trends over a number of years now, which this report picks up on. So there are cost control mechanisms in place there, and that's part of what we'll be keeping an eye on.
Yes, it's just about the local government benchmarking framework. I mean, I was fascinated to look at these figures. I noticed, for example, that despite the reductions in local government funding, if you look at housing, for example, the percentage of dwellings meeting the Scottish Housing Quality Standard has increased from 53.6 to 90.4%, a phenomenal improvement in only 4 years. And if you look at energy efficiency, that's went up from 74.9% to 96.5%. So, I mean, that, again, is first class. But I'm just wondering whether there is consistency across all 32 local authorities, or if there are local authorities which significantly digress from some of these, the significant progress that's being made. Because what we talked about earlier, and Mr. Hines touched on this, was the was looking at, for example, best practice and how local authorities can share best practice and in terms of reducing costs, but the ability to deliver continuously improved services. So I'm just wondering if that's something that the Accounts Commission are looking at and speaking to particular local authorities who perhaps are not improving as rapidly as some others.
2 points, and then I'll ask Ronnie to come in. Certainly in terms of the next iteration of Best Value, looking at the performance of a council in comparison to its family of councils will be something that we'll highlight much more. Secondly, you're absolutely right to mention the issue of consistency. I mean, I can remember my time in local government, the issue of payment of invoices within 30 days, and some councils used to play games at that because they used to exclude the education invoices which came in the school holidays. For me, the more important thing is not whether you pay the invoice within 30 days. Much more relevant is what's the cost of paying that invoice between your council and a comparable council. But I know directors of finance have been doing a huge amount of work trying to get a greater degree of consistency. Ronnie?
Well, for me, the benchmarking framework, which is what you're drawing our attention to, should be more about improvement than consistency. If everybody was consistently bad, there'd be small comfort in that. So what it's designed to do is to accelerate the rate of improvement. Now, part of that is looking across the border and learning what's going on around you. And some of that will be some consistency because it'll be hopefully levelling up as a consequence.
But
I want to use that as a prelude to make a point in favour of local government. I think it's to their credit that they've got this thing going. It's their initiative. They're running with it. We're keeping a watching eye on it. But it's their baby and it is beginning to demonstrate that actually is leading to some improvement. You've given examples, quoting from the report. There's a real variety in there. You drew attention, for example, to the Scottish Housing Quality Standard. Now, one of the reasons why there is improvement there is because there is a Scottish Housing Quality Standard. So everybody's working to the same script. There's also funding for it, so there's the resources to do it, and that gets you the kind of stellar improvement that you see there. That's not the case in every instance, and I'm not saying it should be. So I take comfort from the fact that some of the others who don't have that kind of fillip are nevertheless demonstrating improvement, even though they've had to reduce the amount of money that goes into some of those services. The key thing for us as a commission, I think, as we look at this and provide whatever assurance we can on it, is to encourage councils to drill right into what it is that's leading to these variations in spend and practice and performance. And some of that is difficult because you're washing your not-so-clean linen in public when you do it, so let's be careful about that and not invite people just to go into a shell. But I think the fact that this information is in the public domain, that we're prepared to put it in a report like this, is itself a good thing. And where I think we want to go next, and we've said this in local government, is that as they begin to analyse what lies behind these figures, they can say things like, and I'll use a different example, educational attainment because it's current, they can say that the improvement that they can show over the last 5 years across all 32 councils in educational attainment, some of that can be explained because of the kind of socio-economic circumstances that obtain to all councils, and again, they vary. Levels of deprivation are a key factor in play if you're trying to improve educational attainment. But they can actually analyse this data now and strip that out and say that that accounts for less than half of the variation between the 32 councils. So once you take things like deprivation out of the mix, you're left with a real question. Why is there still a significant variation of more than 50% between the best and the worst performing council? That's where this needs to go now. Mm. And what we want to do is put our shoulder to the wheel. It would be fine if we did it, but I think it's better if councils do it. They've got ownership, they've got drive, they've got the means of control. So our role is to encourage it, support it, and where necessary, hold them to account for not doing it quickly enough.
Just to say, it'd be interesting to see these figures on a local authority by local authority basis. I know the caveat that you've put in, because I think it would be good to actually see the huge improvements in some local authorities and then look at why maybe others are not doing so well against their underlying cost base as well, because I'm sure that some of the ones that are performing best are not necessarily those that are the most expensive in terms of delivering that service.
True.
With our budget scrutiny as well, we drill down local authority spend, I would think. Blaine Smith.
Thanks, Convener. I'm conscious of time, so if you don't mind, I'll ask you 2 points together. First one would be if you could comment on Council's readiness for implementation of the Community Empowerment Act, and secondly, your opinion on the effectiveness of community planning partnerships.
Readiness Community Empowerment Act. Well, I think they have an act. There's a guidance coming out. I think we'll be doing a piece of work to look to how well they are prepared, and looking at the commitment by councils to ensuring that they do engage effectively with communities. There's a whole bit in there in relation to much greater involvement of communities and participation in relation to their budgets. So. Absolutely, it's on our to-do work. In terms of community planning, as you know, the Commission jointly with the Auditor Generals, as we've done a series of reports on community planning. We have no intention to do further work in relation to that, but it's a subject we will keep under review. I think it's interesting to make the comparison, if you want, and I'll be quick on this, between how effective community planning has been as a voluntary partnership as opposed to what the expectation is in relation to integrated joint boards, which are statutory partnerships, where there's a clear accountability to ministers if things don't work effectively. So I think there'll be an interesting comparison between the two. I think, one, having said that, I think a key to the effectiveness of IJBs is something that we highlighted on more than one occasion in relation to community planning, the importance of building a culture of trust between the council and the partners around the table. And that's a particular issue in relation to health and local government, who come from very different cultures. The councillor's background is quite different from an executive in the health board. And I think it's really important that the IGBs do spend time and effort in building that culture of trust, to make sure there's a common understanding around the table, that they're not here for the council, they're not here for the health board, they're here for what's in the best interest of the integrated joint board and the challenge of getting people out of acute hospital beds into care in the community or care at home. So there are lessons for IGBs to learn and draw upon from studying the experience of community planning.
Okay. Thank you. We look forward to your report in due course.
We just wanted to make sure that as a committee we covered as much of the content and range of the report as possible. Hopefully feel we've done much of that in what's been a long evidence session this morning. We're very, very grateful for the time and effort here this morning. There's a brief, I suppose, opportunity, given the fact we're overrunning, for something Mr. Sinclair or one of your team would maybe want to put on the record before we formally close this particular evidence session. Now would be an opportunity to do that.
I simply say that I think we've enjoyed the opportunity to discuss the overview report with you. I think there may be other opportunities. I think we'd certainly welcome the opportunity to discuss with you the development of Best Value going forward, the next iteration of Best Value, and the fact that will apply to all 32 councils and not simply to councils that are not performing well, and making sure that we can provide assurance to the public on the performance of every council in Scotland. I think that I'm sure would be an issue of considerable interest to the committee.
Okay, well, can I thank you, Mr. Sinclair, and the entire team for your time this morning. That completes agenda item 1, and we're now moved to agenda item 2. We'll give a few minutes just to allow witnesses to leave, and we'll go to agenda item 2. Apologies, just for clarity, can we suspend just for a couple of moments for a comfort break? Thank you. Okay, so we now move to agenda item 2, which is consideration of petition PE1534. At agenda item 2 this afternoon, we are invited to consider petition PE1534 by Claire Simmons on behalf of Planning Democracy on Equal Rights of Appeal in the Planning System. We discussed this petition at last week's meeting when we heard from the independent panel and Minister on the review of the planning system. In thinking what we do with this petition, I would note that both the independent review of the planning system and the Scottish Government do not support equal right of appeal. That said, the Scottish Government has announced that a planning bill will be brought forward in autumn next year, which would provide any member with an opportunity, not just in this committee, but across the Parliament, to seek to amend that bill to include an equal right of appeal. The petitioner has also confirmed that they will sit on the working groups that will be looking into recommendations from the recent review of the planning system that's been established by the Scottish Government. Given all that activity, I would be minded to close the petition, but I will, of course, be keen to hear members' views. So, what are members' views? Elaine.
Thanks, Convener. I think on the issues, they do remain pertinent. We had evidence on them, as you mentioned, last week. So it's not that the issue is going away and there are other ways to take it forward. However, I think the terms of the petition are quite clear. It's urging the Scottish Government to review the current rights of appeal, and clearly that isn't going to happen. So, not in the way that the petitioners have urged it with this petition that goes back to 2014. So I think that given that, whether or not members have sympathy or think that the issue is something that they would be keen to pursue, in terms of the actual petition, I think there has to be other ways of pursuing it. So therefore, I would not go against closing the petition.
Okay, that's helpful, Elaine. Thank you. Any other comments from members? Andy?
Thanks, Convener. Yes, I mean, I have a lot of sympathy with the petitioner. One of the bits of evidence that was submitted on this petition related to a case in my constituency where the Ombudsman had made it quite plain that the Council had not taken into account, in fact not sought, a transport impact assessment for development, and there was no way the community could appeal or whatever the decision there. And I think a lot of the demand, a lot of the arguments for this come out of a frustration with the ability of communities and others to properly hold what they consider to be defective decisions or whatever to account in the same way that the applicant can. I agree with Elaine that the petition is urging asks the Parliament to urge the government to review the current rights of appeal, and they've clearly indicated they're not minded to do so. But I think the evidence we heard last week about equalising the rights of appeal, the idea that the arguments for a third party right of appeal, for there not being one, may well apply to the existing rights of appeal that the applicant has. So I think in that context, I would be happy to close the petition, given that this is a debate that's going to continue for some time. And that the substantive point that the petitioner is making will not go away, I don't think, but also mindful of the fact that the Scottish Government has made absolutely clear what its answer to us would be if we were to urge the Scottish Government to review the rights of appeal.
Okay, are there any other comments from members? Yeah, Mr. Stewart?
Just, I agree with both my colleagues on the committee, because we don't have an opportunity to take it any further in this process. But what opportunity would we have to continue to investigate something of this nature, Convener, as we go forward? Because as I say, it is still very pertinent, and there will be the possible opportunity for us to examine again in some way, but not necessarily this petition.
I'll come back to my thoughts on that at the end, Mr. Stewart. Mr. Gibson.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I think we should just remind ourselves what the independent review of the Scottish planning system said in paragraph 46, which was, and I quote, "The evidence shows that a third-party right of appeal would add time, complexity and conflict to the process and have the unintended consequence of centralising decisions, undermining confidence and deterring investment. We believe that using time and resources to focus on improved early engagement would provide much greater benefits." And I believe, given the view of the Scottish Government and the independent review itself, that's the way we should actually move forward when this legislation comes to us next year.
Comments? Could I just very briefly reflect on some of them and perhaps make the obvious point that at last week's evidence session, the matter got quite a significant airing within the committee. And I have no doubt, as we look at the legislative process with the Scottish Government's planning bill, it will again get a significant airing as part of that wider process. And the fact that four members have given fairly specific comments today, I think, should hopefully reassure Planning Democracy and Clare Simmons that will be the case. But of course, we're not this morning here deciding whether or not we are sympathetic or not towards the equal right of appeal, but whether we should close the petition or not. And given that members who have intimated a sympathy towards equal right of appeal are still content with the caveats that I gave at the outset for the petition to be closed, can I seek agreement from members to close the petition? Okay, thank you very much. We now move to agenda item 3, the appointment of a European reporter. And I will invite volunteers or nominations for that role.
Nominate Andy Whiteman.
Okay, Andy, you've been nominated. Are there any other? Maybe there's no other nominations, Mr. Whiteman. I know he'd indicated interest before the session started, but just for clarity, can I ask if there are any other nominations? Okay. Mr. Whiteman, would you be content to take on that role?
Yes, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, congratulations on assuming that role as the committee's European reporter. And that ends agenda item 3, and we'll be moving on to agenda item 4, consideration of evidence which we previously agreed to take in private and I suspend.